This morning I have two locks, but only one combination. You see, this lock I first got whenever I would go swimming or go ice skating, and I would need a lock to lock my locker. And so I have written down this combination to this lock, and I think I can still remember it this morning, so that this lock still opens, and I know the combination to this lock. However, this lock, on the other hand, is the lock my husband bought the day he proposed to me, because we were going ice skating, so he needed a lock to lock our locker and didn't realize that I already had a lock. But he bought this lock, and in his excitement, he can no longer remember the combination to this lock. So as try as we may, we cannot get this lock to open. But perhaps these two locks and the one combination will have something to say to us today as we finish our series on prayer. Over the last 5 weeks, we've been venturing together into this series of prayer, journeying into this, having this attitude of unlocking God's heart. If you remember all the way back to the first week that we spent together, I said that this sermon series was based on the idea that prayer is the key to unlocking God's heart of abundant love for us. And so over the last several weeks, we have talked about prayer, and it's my hope that these different ideas about prayer or practices about prayer have helped you to begin a prayer practice in your life or to expand one that you may have already been doing. And it's my hope that these ideas that we have talked about together will help you create your own combination to unlocking God's heart of abundant love for you. This week, I was spending time in prayer in the morning, which is what I have committed to. And it was Tuesday morning, and I realized that part of my own unique prayer combination is that I need to go to a quiet, private space. So I go into a room and close the door early in the morning. It's one of the first things I do after I get up. And I go in there and I simply name my simple prayers to God, my praises, my concerns, my requests. I name these elements to God, and then I sometimes pray for others, and then I will just sit in silence and wait to hear what God has to say to me. And so on Tuesday morning, when I was in the room praying, and I had got to the time where I normally just sit in silence, that morning I pictured Jesus sitting across from me. I was seated at a chair, and I pictured that Jesus was holding my hands, seated across from me. And I had this overwhelming sense and this desire to raise my head to look up into Jesus' face, but I was afraid. I think I was afraid because I wasn't quite sure what I was going to find there. Would I see anger or judgment? What would I see in Jesus' face? Could I even look up at him? But I realized, as I lifted my head, all that was in Jesus' face was not anger or condemnation. What was in Jesus' face was abundant, extravagant, limitless love for me. And I was so overwhelmed in that moment. As I just sat there, I could do nothing else but to sit there and bask in the love that Jesus has for me. And as I was sitting there trying to receive Jesus' love, my love for Jesus overflowed and increased. My love for Chris and others overflowed. In fact, I knew in that moment that after my prayer time was done, I needed to go upstairs and make sure that my husband knew how much I loved him before he left for work. My love for all of you greatly increased, and I lifted up your concerns before Jesus in that time of prayer. And it was a beautiful, intimate encounter with Jesus. You see, because over these last couple weeks, I've been talking about that we're on this journey towards unlocking God's heart of abundant love for us. But I'll be honest with you, I think I was beginning to doubt if I or any of us would really experience the abundance of God's love through prayer. If prayer is really the key to unlocking God's heart, would we really experience? then Tuesday morning it unexpectedly happened for me, and it was such a beautiful, intimate experience with God that it's something I hope all of you will experience. I hope that each one of you will find your own unique combination that allows you to be in God's presence, to unlock and experience God's abundant love for you. But here's the unexpected thing I learned Tuesday that I wasn't expecting to learn. This whole time as we have been journeying through this prayer series, I keep talking about that we're on this journey towards unlocking God's heart of abundant love for us. But on Tuesday, I had a question that came to my mind. Whose heart really needs unlocking? Does God's heart need unlocking? Or really, is it my heart that needs unlocking? You see, because Tuesday morning I came to realize that God's heart is always open, willing and ready to pour out extravagant, life-giving love to us. It's often my heart, our hearts, that are locked and closed. I find it difficult to receive God's love. You see, because we get so caught up in the busyness of our lives that we forget that prayer is a vital part of our combination to putting ourselves in position to receive God's love and to share that love with everyone else we come in contact with. Many of you probably know the famous story of the Good Samaritan out of Luke 10. But do we know how that story begins? In Luke 10, beginning in verse 25, there's a lawyer who stands up to test Jesus. Now, this isn't a legal lawyer here like we would picture today. Instead, this is an interpreter of Torah, or the Jewish scriptures. That's who this person is. And so he knows the scripture incredibly well, but he stands up to test Jesus and says, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus says to him, "Well, you clearly are the interpreter of the law. You know what's written there." And so Jesus says, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" And so the lawyer answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said this to the lawyer, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, the lawyer asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied with this story. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Now, this is an important detail in the story because the road that went down from Jerusalem to Jericho descended 3,600 feet in less than 20 miles. This was a very steep, narrow, windy, rocky road. It was such a dangerous road that it earned the name of the Bloody Way. And people rarely traveled this road alone. It was so dangerous and home to many bandits and robbers. And so this man, for one reason or the other, was traveling down from Jerusalem to Jericho alone on this Bloody Way. And so as a result, he fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. This priest knew that any contact with a dead man would make him unclean for 7 days. And being unclean for 7 days meant that he might miss his turn to serve in the temple. And so the priest's religion kept him from showing love to this dying man. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. On this Bloody Way, it was very common for bandits to stage a decoy. One of them would act like the dying man, and then when somebody came up to help, that all the bandits would come and attack that helper and leave that helper as a half-dead victim. And so perhaps the Levite knew of this, and the Levite, for him, perhaps his security, his safety was more important than the life of this dying man. And And so his concern for his own safety kept him from showing love. But a Samaritan who this lawyer and the Jews have hated and been in a family feud at this point for over 400 years, a Samaritan, while traveling, came near to this dying man, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to the inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, which would have been worth 2 days' wages, and gave them to the innkeeper and said, "Take care of him. And when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend." Which of these 3, Jesus said to the lawyer, do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The lawyer said, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. Love God, love neighbor. That's what Jesus tells us to do. But why does something that seems so simple often be so hard for us to do? And what I have come to realize this week is I think it's often so difficult for us to love God and love neighbor because we're not. You see, I don't know about you, but when I go through seasons in my life where I don't pray or prayer is not a priority, then my heart becomes hardened and closed and shut off, and I'm not open to receive God's abundant love for me, and so God's love is not flowing into me or out of me. I'm just closed, a closed circuit, locked off from God and from others and from the world. But when prayer is a priority in my life, when I realize prayer is a vital part of the combination of my spiritual life, my heart becomes open. And it's so much easier to receive God's love and to love God and to love others. I find myself more in tune with God, talking with God more often throughout the day. I find myself more filled with those fruits of the Spirit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control. I find it easier to love those around me. As I told you about my story from Tuesday morning, immediately my love for Chris continued to increase, and my love for all of you increased. But you guys are easy to love, and I mean that in all sincerity. It is such a blessing to serve here, and I love being your pastor, and I hope you know that. You and Chris are easy to love. But what about the people in my life who it's difficult to love? What about them? What about the people who have hurt me or betrayed me or disappointed me? What about the people who have hurt people I love? What about the terrorists who have attacked this nation and nations around the world that want us to live in fear? Do I really have to love them and pray for them? But then these words struck me this week as I was reading the newspaper. This is an article from the Public Opinion that perhaps many of you saw, because I realized that perhaps I'm not alone in this feeling that's difficult to love people. Perhaps you have people in your life who it's difficult to love. People who look different from you, talk different from you, have a different upbringing from you, practice a different religion from you, think differently from you. Whatever it is, there are people that are difficult for us to love. And when I saw this article, it broke my heart, because this article says that there are 917 hate groups in the United States, 40 of which are in Pennsylvania. And you can see a little better on this map that one of them is in State Line, which is where I live, and 2 of them are very close to where I grew up in Western Pennsylvania. And this broke my heart that there are groups of people who come together out of their shared hate for other people, people who have a different skin color than them or different ethnicity or practice that hate is on the rise in our nation and in the world. But then the words of Jesus came to me out of Matthew 5:44, that I am to love my enemy and to pray for those who persecute me, that I am to love and pray for those people in my life who it's difficult to love, those people in my life who I would rather pass by on the other side or perhaps even cause them harm, that I'm supposed to love and pray for even the people of these hate groups that breaks my heart that they're a part of. We are to love even our enemies and to pray for them. You see, I think prayer is an essential part of the combination to not just unlocking God's abundant heart of love for us. I think God's heart is always open, ready to pour out that love for us. We're just often not in the position to receive it. Because I think prayer is a vital part of our combination to unlocking and opening our hearts, to receive God's abundant love, and to allow God's love to bubble up inside of us and overflow into all those people we encounter in our daily lives, those who are easy to love and those who are not so easy to love. This is what Jesus commands of us. That we must be people of prayer so that we can love God and love others. And our world demands this of us, perhaps at such a time as this. At such a time as this, when hate seems to be on the rise, when there are people who want to destroy entire nations through atomic weapons, or where we're in a world where genocide still exists, where gun violence still takes the lives of children in our cities. We're in a world that desperately needs us to be vehicles of love. This week, may we commit to finding our unique prayer combination that puts us in position to experience God's abundant love for us, and then to allow that love to bubble up within us and flow out to all the people that we encounter. The world and God demands us to be vessels and vehicles of love. So this week, may we go forth and allow our hearts to be open, to be vehicles of love, people of prayer, in a world